Penguin Random House presents A Childhood in Tibet by Thérèse Obrecht Hodler. Read by Tenzin, Kalsang. Please refer to the supplemental PDF for additional information and images provided for each chapter in the book. Foreword. Tibet is an ancient land whose people have a long history and a rich culture deeply rooted in Buddhism. In the 8th century, a Tibetan king, Chisong Deutsen, invited the Indian master Shantarakshita from the historical Nalanda University to establish Buddhism in the land of snow. The Nalanda tradition placed special emphasis on the study of logic and philosophy, an approach preserved today in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition. Following communist Chinese invasion of Tibet, terrible atrocities occurred in the east and northeast of Tibet, resulting in the destruction of villages and monasteries in response to resistance by people from these regions against communist Chinese subjugation. Thousands of Tibetans, spiritual teachers, and other leaders among them were humiliated, imprisoned, tortured, and even killed. Refugees arriving in Lhasa from these areas corroborated the sad and horrific events. Despite our sincere efforts at peaceful coexistence, Chinese authorities in Lhasa were intent in crushing any form of resistance. As a result, these events led to the Tibetan People's Uprising of 1959. It is now over 60 years since a large number of Tibetans, including myself, were forced to flee Tibet. The generation of Tibetans who lived through this critical period is fast dwindling. It is therefore important to preserve memories of a freer Tibet while there are still people who can relate their first-hand perspective on this important moment in global history. A Childhood in Tibet on Tendöl Namling is the story of the life of a Tibetan family and a child born at this sad point in Tibetan history. Tendöl is the youngest daughter of the late Belgyur Jigme Namseling, then one of Tibet's four tsibuns, or finance secretaries. She spent the first 22 years of her life under Chinese rule. The book not only conveys the story of her life in Tibet, but also the unflinching determination of fellow Tibetans to preserve our rich Tibetan Buddhist culture. It provides us with a glimpse of the changes in Tibetan society brought about by Communist China's assault on Tibet's identity, religion, culture of peace, and compassion. It also highlights the resilience of the Tibetan people as they work to sustain their distinctive culture. It is, at its core, a testimony to the Tibetan people's peaceful struggle for freedom. I hope this book will help readers to understand better not only the tragedy that has befallen Tibetans, but also the significance of our peaceful aspiration for freedom and dignity, an aspiration that can speak to people in every culture and situation. Author's note. In March 2019, Tendöl Namling turned 60, just as old as the Tibetan uprising. She was born on the same day the Dalai Lama escaped Lhasa under the cover of darkness, disguised, when the People's Liberation Army of China ruthlessly suppressed the uprising of his people. She spent the first 22 years of her life under Chinese rule. As the daughter of a high-ranking Tibetan government official, she experienced the brutality of China's re-education policy with full force. She has many painful memories of those years and a few crumpled photos which she always carried with her. The photos with her friends and cousins in Lhasa, smiling as if nothing had happened. Whenever the girls saved some money, they posed for portraits in Chinese photo studios. Tendöl, like thousands of other Tibetan and also Chinese youths, worked for years on road construction. She hid the photos under her pillow and cried herself to sleep at night. She did not possess any documents from this tragic period except the arrest warrant for her mother, who was sentenced to 10 years in prison. As I was researching for this book, Tendöl often had difficulty giving me accurate information. When exactly was she doing road construction? When was she allowed to go to school for a short time? When did she complete her apprenticeship as a motor mechanic? But she clearly remembered her feelings of those years. The anguish that her mother might be executed. The longing for her caring love. The aggravating hunger that drove her to eat pig food in a Chinese garrison. The horror of the public executions that she was forced to attend. The corpses in the courtyards of the prisons. The defenselessness against men in uniform. Tendöl wanted her painful childhood to be recorded so that the history of Tibet and the repression by China that continues to this day will not be forgotten. Her memories were buried deep in her innermost being and came back in bits and pieces, often out of context. Sometimes she wiped away a tear from her eyes, especially when talking about her mother. But mostly, she told the story of her childhood as if she were talking about another person in another world. Although she was not allowed to practice her faith under the Chinese rule, she embraced the Buddhist principles from an early age. She believed that things come and go, that nothing is permanent. She was able to let go and never lost faith in the positive path. This belief saved her during her childhood in Tibet and was always with her in Switzerland. Chapter 1, March 1959, An Uprising and a Birth. On 17th March 1959, the 24-year-old Dalai Lama escaped Lhasa, disguised as a soldier, as night falls. Undetected, with a few loyal companions, he marched past the huge crowd of Tibetans that gathered to protect their leaders with their lives. The fate of Tibet then changed forever. A week earlier, on 10th March, the Chinese military commander invited His Holiness the Dalai Lama to the army headquarters, but without his bodyguards. The Tibetan uprising broke out. The fear that their leader could fall into the hands of the People's Liberation Army was unbearable for the Tibetans. They erected barricades in the narrow streets of Lhasa while the PLA positions artillery in the city. Leaflets called for resistance against the Chinese invaders. Rumors of treason and kidnapping made the rounds. Nomads passing through Lhasa whispered of tens of thousands of Chinese soldiers being in position at the boundaries of the city. In his summer residence, the Norbalinka, the Dalai Lama discussed the critical situation with his advisors. If he stays, there will be violence. If he leaves, there will be violence as well. 2 days later, on 19th March, when the word of the Dalai Lama's escape became public in Lhasa, street fighting between Tibetans and Chinese soldiers broke out. Poorly armed Tibetans faced overpowering Chinese military might. The PLA stationed in Lhasa since 1951 brutally crushed the uprising. The Tibetan problems must be solved by force, telegraphed Chairman Mao Zedong. Tens of thousands of Tibetans died in the following days in hand-to-hand battles and under artillery fire. Lhasa's three main monasteries, Sera, Gande, and Dipung, were destroyed. Thousands of monks were arrested or executed. Their monasteries destroyed and irreplaceable Buddhist scriptures burned. After a few days, the Tibetan resistance was shattered. Exhausted, the Dalai Lama and his companions arrived in India on 31st March. The adventurous escape, often at night, on foot or on horseback, in a small yak leather boat across the Kichu River, Brahmaputra, and in a snow flurry over the Sabola Pass, turned out to be successful. Still on Tibetan soil, the Dalai Lama revoked the infamous 17-point agreement of 1951, which Tibetan officials were forced to sign by the People's Republic of China. The Indian Prime Minister, Jawaharlal Nehru, allocated available land to the Tibetans in the foothills of the Himalayas. The Dalai Lama was permitted, as the spiritual but not the political head, to lead a central Tibetan administration in Dharamshala, but officially not a government in exile. Over the next few years, tens of thousands of Tibetans followed the Dalai Lama into exile and continued to regard him as their political leader as well. In the midst of these tragic events, little Tenzin Doma, called Tendöl, was born in Lhasa under dramatic circumstances as the last child of the Namsiling family. Chugi was in labor when Chinese armed officers came to arrest Tendöl's mother, the wife of Tibet's Secretary of State for Finance. They lifted the blanket, saw blood, and left the mother alone at the time. But shortly after Tendöl's birth, a friend assisting Chugi as midwife was arrested in place of the mother. It was not in Tendöl's fate to meet her father, Beljor Jingme Namsiling, who joined the Tibetan Kampa resistance and eventually escaped to India. A pain that she carries with her all her life. As Putu, a child of class enemies, Tendöl pays a high price for her origins. Her father, a high-ranking Tibetan civil servant and member of the upper classes, owner of the Namsiling Manor, a 17th-century property on the banks of the Kichu, embodies for the communist invaders the Tibetan feudal society which was to be exterminated. Chapter 2. 18 months earlier. In September 1957, Tendöl's mother, Chugi, her five children, Soyang, Dögar, Tenzin, Tenor, and Ngudrup, as well as their cousin Pema and half-sister Sodun, had traveled to India under the ploy of going on pilgrimage. With an entourage of horses and pack animals, loaded with plenty of supplies for the long and arduous journey, the family and two companions crossed the Nathula Pass on foot, the border between Tibet and Sikkim, 4,300 meters above sea level. Nobody imagined then that this pass would be closed and the border to Tibet sealed off for decades until today. Chugi knew that this time around they were not real pilgrims like a year earlier, when she and the children had traveled to Bodh Gaya, the place of Buddha's enlightenment in India. This trip was about bringing their eldest daughters to safety. Since the invasion of the PLA forces in the early 50s, the pressure on Tibetans had increased rapidly. The Chinese tried by all means to lure as many Tibetan children as possible into Chinese schools. Many upper-class Tibetans, including the Namsiling family, wanted to prevent their children from being raised in a communist system and sent them to missionary schools abroad. So Chugi brought her three older daughters to Kalimpong in India and enrolled the girls in the Catholic St. Joseph's Convent. Chugi spent 5 months in Kalimpong. The 28-year-old enjoyed the colorful flora, the mild climate, and especially the last days she was able to spend with all her children together. She accompanied the girls to the cinema, they listened to music, sang, and danced. Then Chugi returned to Lhasa with her two youngest, Tenor and Ngudrup, and with a heavy heart, leaving Soyang, Dögar, and Tenzin back in India. On their way back to Tibet, they met a large number of Tibetans fleeing to India. Chugi became increasingly apprehensive not only with regard to the situation in Lhasa, but also to the future of Tibet and of her own family. Chapter 3. China Seizure of Power Tears the Family Apart. The Namsiling family have been in Tibetan public service since the reign of the 5th Dalai Lama. Tendöl's great-grandfather, a general, was killed in 1904 when the British Indian Army invaded Tibet. Her father, Beljor Jingme Namsiling, began his Tibetan government service in 1925. From 1935, he spent 4 years as the military commander on the eastern border between Tibet and Xining. In 1940, he became governor of Shigatse, the second largest city in Tibet. Twice widowed and already the father of three daughters, he met Chugi, who was 20 years younger than him. They married in 1944, and 2 years later they moved to Lhasa, where Beljor Jingme became one of four state secretaries in the Ministry of Finance. Beljor Jingme and Chugi Namsiling lived in a two-story house in Kandrol Habrang, in the center of Lhasa. The house was given to their son, Tenor, the sixth Khandrul Rinpoche.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.